The book of Exodus, chapter number 20, verse number 4, the Bible says, "Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image, or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth." You say, "Well, what are you talking about there?" Just go out to Petoskey out in the bay. And they have an image out there that people go. They cut a hole in the ice and they can go take a peek at it there. "Thou shalt not bow down thyself to them, nor serve them." Why should we not? "For I am the Lord thy God. I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments." I don't know everything about you, but I know one thing about you, and that is God created in you an instinctive desire to worship Him. It's true of all men everywhere. Man worships instinctively, almost instinctively as men breathe. You were created for worship. You say, "Pastor, what about an atheist?" Well, it's my conviction that nobody is born an atheist. I've talked to a number of them, and I really don't even believe that an atheist is an atheist. I believe that an atheist is somebody who's made a decision to not allow God to be involved in his life. The Bible says the fool has said in his heart, "There is no God." The atheist does not have an intellectual problem. The problem is not in his head. The fool hath said in his head, the fool hath determined in his mind. The atheist does not have an intellectual problem, he has a moral problem. The fool hath said in his heart, "There is no God." An atheist is someone who will not give God credit. He's not going to give God credit for anything. In fact, an atheist would rather give credit to himself. An atheist draws worship to himself. And he draws praise under false pretense because he's stealing praise from God and assigning it to himself. Man has this instinctive desire to worship God. Man was created. You were created to worship. And if you don't worship the one true God, you will worship a false God. And you'll worship that false God in the wrong way if you don't worship God in the right way. And your worship will be wrong. Last week we looked at the first commandment, and it helps us to remember that the first four commandments are commandments that relate from man toward God, how we relate to our God. Then the balance of the commandments, the next six, those commandments deal with how we relate to our fellow man. The order is very obvious. If our relationship is not right with God, our relationship cannot be right with our fellow man. You can't tell me. Save your breath for blowing on your soup. You can't tell me that your relationship with other people is right if your relationship is not right with the Lord. And the converse is true. You cannot have proper relationships in life if your relationship first with God is not right. What did he say? He said this. He said, "I am the Lord thy God." As we look at the second commandment, we're going to notice that it tells us how to worship God. First commandment obviously forbids false gods because it establishes the one true God. But it is the second commandment, I believe, that focuses primarily on false worship. I want to look at the second commandment, and I want to look at it under three simple steps, okay? It's not 3 points in a poem and then the meal. But here's the thing. I'm just asking the Lord to help me, in a simple way, relate these truths from God's Word. You say, "Pastor, whoa. We're looking in Exodus at the old commandments. I thought things are different after Calvary." Well, praise the Lord that the Lord sent Jesus Christ, his Son, to save us, die for us, so that we could be with him. And that's wonderful. But the commandments that God gave give us an understanding of who God is and how God relates to man. You have to remember, these folks were brought out of Egypt. They were living in raw paganism. They didn't even know God. And God is using the commandments to teach his people about himself. The way that applies to us this morning is we are learning about God and how we as believers can worship the one true God. How many of you think that you have reached an all-time high with no improvement for your worship of God? I guess I better put my hand down too. In order to keep the second commandment, in order to understand it, we understand this. It begins with a proper concept of God. Would you say that with me? A proper concept of God. Say it one more time, like everybody together, and say it like you really mean it. Ready? A proper concept of God. That is the reason why God has emphatically forbidden making any kind of graven image. Because a graven image is a misrepresentation of who God is. No God who is as spiritual as our God is could ever be represented in an accurate way by anything that's material, physical, or visible. You know what the Bible tells us about God? In fact, he tells us about himself. No man hath seen God at any time. No man hath seen God at any time. And sometimes I'll hear people say, oh, you know, I had this vision or whatever, and I have to go back to that scripture that says, no man hath seen God at any time. No spiritual God could be represented in the physical realm. The Bible tells us in John chapter 4 about God, that God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Boy, I like that. The Bible brings truth into our worship. You know, so much of the baloney that's going on, and that's just the proper term for it, it's baloney. There's so much of the baloney that's going on in these days that's called worship is dishonest. The focus is on the stage. What are the spotlights on? They're not shining up to God. No, they're shining on the guy that's twanging on the guitar or beating on the drums. I want you to think about that. If our worship is true, it'll point like a giant arrow to the Lord Jesus Christ. They that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. We need to have a proper concept of God. You've heard about the little girl. She's in Sunday school. They had to finish the lesson. They're taking a few minutes to do a little drawing, and a teacher comes up and watches this girl. I mean, she's just working it. She's just coloring. She says, honey, what are you coloring? She says, well, I'm coloring a picture of God. She says, honey, nobody's ever seen God. She says, give me 5 minutes and you'll see. Give me 5 minutes. But that's not so. We laugh about it. There is nothing visible, tangible, physical, that will ever represent the great, immortal, invisible, eternal, spiritual God. That's the reason the book of Isaiah, chapter number 40. I want you to turn there. I want you to see what the Lord is telling us in relationship to gods. The book of Isaiah, you should find it very easily after you come through the Psalms and just keep moving forward. It's a larger book. Isaiah chapter number 40 and verse number 25. I included this verse because I thought it was a perfect verse as a companion to the truth that's being taught in the second commandment. Isaiah 40 and verse number 25. Brother Steve, would you be willing to read this verse nice and loud? The book of Isaiah, chapter number 40, and verse number 25.
To whom then will you liken me, or shall Who are you going to compare God with?
Who? That's what he asks about himself. Thank you so much, Brother Steve.
Maybe the worst thing about an image is that it is supposed to represent God, but it doesn't do the job. So it represents something that's distorting or misleading. I can tell you this. How many of you have seen a picture of yourself and you say this? That is not a good picture of me. How many of you? That is not a good picture of me. I don't remember the numbers, but in this day of selfies, in this day of we talk about having, there's so much talk about positive self-image, but I read somewhere that folks who are really into this, taking selfies of themselves, will take, on average, over 20 selfies for every single one that they post. They're very concerned about what they look like and the image that they portray. How many of you love your driver's license photo? Of course not. Of course not. If you don't think that one's very nice, you should see the one on my passport. My wife drove by. I was on top of a roof. She said, "Honey, I just got my passport photo." She said, "I got everything through. There's nobody at the post office. You need to get a passport photo right now." I said, "Right now? Right now." I had shingle dust all over me. My hair was a mess. And the lady didn't seem to mind. And she just took the picture. It's on my passport. It's engraved there. And I'm supposed to look at it for 10 years, I guess. When we have a photo made, we have Photoshop. Touch it up. Make it look good. Because we want to make sure it looks like us, or at least how we feel that we look. And we really like everybody to see the best version of us that we can. And that's why glamour shots are so popular. You probably heard about the lady. She had a photo commissioned from a photo to a painting. She got a very skilled painter. And he called her after a couple weeks and said, "Ma'am, I have your painting, the portrait's done. I'd like you to come look at it." So she came in and came into the hall. As soon as she came into the hall, his phone rang. He said, "Excuse me, I need to take this." He stepped into the next room. When he came back off of the call, she was just boiling mad. She said, "Listen, if you think I'm going to pay the kind of money you told me that portrait cost, there's no way. My skin is far too pale. I look sickly. I look tired. You put way too many wrinkles on the photo. My eyes have bags under them. I can't believe that you would so unfairly represent what I look like." He said, "Ma'am, that's a mirror. That's a mirror." What's wrong with a graven image? What's wrong with a graven image of God? It degrades him. And it misrepresents him. It distorts the idea of God. But beyond misrepresenting God, God prohibits images because when a person worships an image, he's worshiping the work of his own hands. It becomes a form of self-worship. When man worships the work of his own hands, he is at very best worshiping himself. At the very core, the image worship turns God into a human and defiles man. Man is created in the image of God. And image worship defiles man. Show me any culture. This is an interesting study. But show me any culture that's steeped into idol worship, and I'll show you a culture also that debases and degrades mankind. It goes hand in hand. After we've gotten enough sense to know that it's not really God, it just kind of reminds us that nobody could ever measure up. There's something very debasing and degrading about idol worship. That all sounds pretty good. But people say, "You know, Pastor, let's get real. We know we're not worshiping this idol. I mean, it just makes us think of God. And so that's okay." But the problem is that doesn't fit in a human sense. If a guy walked into his house and found his wife with her arms wrapped around the UPS guy. He said, "What are you doing?" "Well, honey, I'm worshiping you. I'm loving on you." "No, you're not." "Oh, yeah. This guy has all the same qualities that you have. And when I hugged him, it just reminded me of you. I just feel closer to you by doing this." Do you see the problem with idol worship? I know this looks bad, but let me tell you, this reminded me so much of you. I really was just thinking of you. Would anybody buy that? Of course not. God said, "Don't worship idols. I'm a jealous God." Let's go back to our original text. I want you to see the wording. There's something else we want to understand about this. Now I hasten. Say, "Pastor, God says he's a jealous God." That's correct. We read it correctly. Verse 5, "Thou shalt not bow thyself to them, nor serve them. I am the Lord thy God. I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquity of the fathers upon the children unto the third and fourth generation of them that hate me." The Lord is not talking about the kind of jealousy we're familiar with. And there are some cases in a worldly sense that people are overjealous. An athlete can be jealous of another athlete. But you know what? That's wrong. Because one athlete does not represent athletics. He just participates in it. And he can't own that category. There's room for more than one athlete in the world. Is that correct? One musician does not have the right to be jealous of another musician. We have two pianists at church, very different in the way they play. But for one to be jealous of the other does not make sense because neither of them own music. They simply play an expression of music, and it's wonderful. They can sometimes play off the same music, but yet they play uniquely different in their own style. One pastor doesn't have the right to be jealous of another pastor because one pastor does not control the gospel ministry. You understand what I'm saying? One atheist doesn't have the right to be jealous. One artist. I'm sorry, I'm stuck on atheist. Wow. Lord help it. Pray for me, please. One artist doesn't have the right to be jealous of another artist because he's more qualified or a better artist. But a wife would absolutely have the right to be jealous over her husband because he's been designed by God to be that man, that person in her life. You understand that? You understand we're not talking about suspicion or control over a person. We're not talking about perversion in relationships. When somebody says, "This is my wife," he's not saying this individual belongs to me because people don't own individuals. But if this is true so much in human relationships, how much more does God, a thrice holy God, have a right to be jealous over Israel? He said, "I don't want you worshiping, bowing down to other gods." You know what he said in the book of Isaiah? We don't like this term, but the Bible uses it. He said, "You've gone a whoring after other gods." You know what that tells me? God's pretty serious about this stuff. And I hope you pay attention to it and listen to it. There's right and there's wrong. And God says, in the same way that somebody debases another person by stepping out of their marriage commitment, in that same way, it is a misrepresentation spiritually of what should be when we bow down and worship another god. What's the reminder that he gives us that he's a jealous God? Let's see. The Bible says he visits the iniquity of the fathers upon the children under the third and fourth generation. You say, "Pastor, I don't understand that." God is going to punish a child, a grandchild, and a great-grandchild for the sin of the parent? That's not what it says here.
That's not what it says. I want you to see, I want you to understand what God is trying to tell us. Think about God looking down from heaven. He created the heavens and the earth. All the power in his hand created what we see. He holds it together. The Bible says that everything is held in place. He is the glue of the galaxies. Do you know why we don't fling off into space? Because God is holding it all together. And the God who made it, who holds it all together, who puts oxygen into your lungs so you can move and breathe and live and talk, the guy that gives you energy and strength to get out of bed in the morning, looks down and he sees the very creation of his hand worshiping a dung beetle or a stick or a tree or an animal. People worship their pets. You just hang on, Nellie. It won't be long, and pets will be given human status. We're already at the point where individuals will serve more jail time for hurting a pet than they will for killing a human life. Oh, we're in a messed up place. That's why it's so important we understand what God says about himself. So here's God. How are you going to deal with that? Boy, if I were God and somebody were doing that, worshiping a stick instead of me, boy, I'd just kill him on the spot. But what does God say? Verse number 6, and showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to understand that just because somebody does wrong and gets away with it in his mind does not mean that that's a testament that what they're doing is okay. It's a testament to the long-suffering and the goodness of God. Listen, God will not be a part-time God. God is not partial to sharing his throne or glory with anyone. He is the Lord of all. Did you know that God wants to be first place in your life? Did you know that your heart isn't a duplex? It has a throne. God said, don't make a graven image. In order to keep that commandment, there must be a proper concept of God. Number 2, there needs to be a persuasive communication of God. I want you to think about this. The way we worship God communicates what we believe about him. We teach what we worship. If we worship wrongly, we will teach the wrong lesson about God to a lost world. If you as a parent worship God improperly, then you teach your children the improper concept of God. I worship an image, then I am teaching those that watch me that God is like the image of what I worship rather than who God is. The next part of the verse helps us really to understand why it's so important how you worship, especially if you have children. Some people say, Pastor, it's not fair. A child should never have to suffer for the sins of the fathers. Well, that seems right to you, and it may seem right to me, but friend, what the Bible says is truth, and it doesn't matter whether we think it's fair or not. It's what the Bible says. What God is trying to help us to understand is not just so much that the children are being punished for the sins, but there are consequences to actions. Little children suffer if their daddy is an alcoholic or a dopehead or lazy or unspiritual. The children suffer because of that. Children suffer for the sins of the parents all the time. We see that played out day after day after day. But notice here, God is telling us not that the children will be guilty for the sins of the parents. The children are never held guilty for the sins of the parents. That's not what he's saying. Instead, he's saying that they will suffer as a result of the sins of the parents. What sin is God talking about? Well, we need to see this in context. God has just told us, Don't worship an idol, because I'm a jealous God. I visit the iniquity of the fathers upon the children to the third and fourth generation. Don't miss what he's teaching us. Now, put a little marker there. Go to the book of 2 Corinthians, chapter number 26. I want you to see it plain and simple. 2 Corinthians, chapter number 26. What is all this talk about visiting the iniquity? That iniquity showing up in the second and third generation. We're in 2 Chronicles. Go past the Kings. 1 and 2 Samuel. 1 and 2 Kings. 1 and 2 Chronicles. Boom, you're there. Go to chapter number 26. I want you to see verse number 16. We're in Chronicles. 2 Chronicles 26 and verse number 16. King Uzziah, are you there? Here's King Uzziah. He's a king of Israel. But when he was strong, his heart was lifted up to his destruction, in that he transgressed, he sinned against the Lord his God, and went into the temple of the Lord and burned incense upon the altar of incense. He went to church and he worshiped wrongly the Lord in church. Has everybody got that? It's what he did. There was a way this was supposed to be done. The Lord had laid it out. And Uzziah, for some reason, his heart said, you know what? I'm going to go into the temple and this is what I'm going to do. And he did it. That's the sin of Uzziah. Folks, Uzziah didn't get drunk. Uzziah didn't cheat on his wife. Uzziah didn't steal or commit adultery. He sinned by worshiping the right God in the wrong way. Was he in the right place? Yeah. That's why coming to church does not always equal rightness with God. Because some people can sit in the same church service and have their heart not be right toward the Lord. We're just understanding that. So watch what happens. Look in verse number 17. And Azariah the priest went in after him, and with him fourscore priests of the Lord that were valiant men. And they withstood. They said, hey, you can't do this. They withstood Uzziah the king and said unto him, it appertaineth not unto thee, Uzziah, to burn incense unto the Lord, but to the priests of the sons of Aaron that are consecrated to burn incense. He said, there are specific individuals that are supposed to do this. You're not allowed to do this. Neither shall it be for thine honor from the Lord thy God. Uzziah was very wroth. He had a censer in his hand to burn incense. He said, this is how I worship God. I don't care if you like it. This is how I want to worship. Boy, that sounds familiar. You go to church and people say, I don't care what you think about it. This is how I worship God. Whoa, better watch out for that. Azariah the chief priest and all the priests look upon him, and behold, read with me, he was a leprous in his forehead. God wasn't pleased with it. Let's follow the story a little more. Are you ready? That was Uzziah. Did Uzziah worship God properly? Yes or no? No. Did God punish Uzziah for doing it? Yes or no? Yeah. Let's go to chapter 27, verse number 1. Jotham was 25 years old. This is Uzziah's son. When he began to reign, he reigned 16 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was also Jerusha. She was the daughter of Zadok. And he did that which was right in the sight of the Lord. Yippee! Happy story. Are we good with Jotham so far? Yeah. Did he do the right thing? Yeah. Is he living right? Is he doing right? Yeah. According to all that his father Uzziah did, how be it? Are you with me? He entered not into the temple of the Lord. Was Jotham a bad man? No. But he said, you know what? My dad went into that temple. All he wanted to do was worship God. We don't know what the problem was. Is it possible? I'm not saying it is. I'm just saying, is it possible that something about that punishment that Uzziah received set Jotham off? He said, you know what? What God did there, I don't agree with that. I ain't going into that temple.
All my dad did was want to worship God. He got leprosy. That was wrong. You know, and we hear this so much. His heart was in the right place. Folks, God didn't care if Uzziah's heart was in the right place. Uzziah was disobedient to the Lord. So now we have Jotham, who won't go into the house of the Lord. Is Jotham a bad person, yes or no? But look at the consequence that follows. What happened to God's people? The people did yet corruptly. No doubt he is a good man, but he refused to go to the church house. I don't know why. The Bible doesn't tell us why. But we aren't finished with it yet. Let's go to Uzziah's grandson, chapter 27, verse 9. And Jotham slept with his fathers. That means he died. They buried him in the city of David, Jerusalem. And Ahaz, his son, reigned in his stead. Ladies and gentlemen, you don't have to read much about Ahab, and you'll come to this conclusion. Ahaz was a wicked man. He was wicked. Two generations away from Uzziah, we have somebody who is almost godless. Ahaz nailed the doors to the house of God shut. He substituted idols and a false worship. Uzziah had misguided worship. Jotham neglected worship. Ahaz corrupted worship. That's how it goes. Do we see how important the worship of our God is? Number three. Not only should there be a proper concept of God, not only should there be, I want to get the wording correctly, I get tied up with my words, a proper concept of God, number two, a persuasive communication of who God is, but the third point is this. There should be a prayerful contemplation of God. Not everything is in the negative. Look at verse number 6. We're back in the book of Exodus, chapter number 20. And then we'll finish. And showing mercy unto thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. You know, too many people quit reading the commandment in the Bible too soon. The Bible says God is not a God of judgment, primarily. He's a God of mercy. You know what Jesus said about God? He said, be ye merciful as my Father also is. Merciful. Merciful to them that love him. Merciful to them that keep his commandments. Just because you worship an idol does not mean that God does not love you and God does not desire mercy towards you. Just because you don't worship an idol does not mean that you've kept the commandment. We'll see why. You say, well, I don't worship idols, Pastor. There's no idols in my house. The Bible says, until you love God with all your heart, all your soul, all your mind, all your strength, you've left something undone in your life. We are to love the Lord our God. There is to be a prayerful contemplation of God, of what worship is. Worship is loving God. It's adoring God. It's praising God. It's reverencing God. Do you do that? Do you reverence God? Does he have first place in your life? There's absolutely nothing more important in your life than the worship of God. Did you catch that? Nothing. God desires it. In the book of John, Jesus told this woman, the Samaritan woman, says the Father is looking for, he desires for these kinds of people to worship him. He said, God is actively looking. Folks, that's New Testament. God desires to be worshiped by you. Worship isn't what happens here at church. Now, we want to help you. And we want to create an atmosphere that helps you to worship. And I think there's some parts of what we do that's worship also. But friend, understand that you bring your worship with you. And when you leave, you take it with you. Because worship is not something that happens here 1 or 2 or 3 hours a week. Worship is something that's supposed to happen in your life 24/7. That all that we do praises the Lord. That all that we do honors the Lord. That all that we do puts God first in life. Not, okay, it's Sunday. Let's put our worship duds on. Friend, all your duds ought to be worship duds. All of them. And when you put something on and you look in the mirror and say, God, does this honor you? I've taken to throw a few things away from time to time. I just look at it and think, you know, I just don't think that this represents a Christian properly. It's those beer shirts my wife buys me all the time. I'm teasing about that. And sometimes for me, it's just something that's raggier, something that's looks sloppy. And I say, you know, Lord, I don't think this represents you well. If I, as a believer, I'm supposed to represent you, just pitch it. I know we're sentimentally attached to stuff, aren't we? Why should there be this contemplation of our worship? First of all, because God desires it. Number two, because God deserves it. Who made you? Who feeds you? Who strengthens you? Who saved you? Who desires to live forever with you? The answer to all those things is God. He deserves it. If we were to take the word worship and break it down in the origin of the word worship is attached to the word worth. You go to somebody's house and you look at something, you're like, that's kind of weird. They're like displaying this item. What is it? You don't know what that is? I have no idea. It's just an object. Oh, no, that's not just any object. They'll tell you what it is. You know, this was handed down from my grandmother and my great-grandmother. And, you know, this thing's like 5,000 years old. It's worth $5 million. And you're like, oh, okay. Now I get it. Because it's ugly. Oh, but this has value. I'm like, okay, I understand that. The word worship is attached to the word worth. Not only does God desire your worship, He deserves it. And one more thing, truthfully, God demands it. You know what God told Satan? He said, it's written, you're to worship the Lord your God and Him only. That's what He said. God demands that. Friend, God demands, He desires, and He deserves first place in your life. Nothing less. Nothing less. See that license plate from once in a while? God is my co-pilot. I just want to rip that thing right off. What kind of statement does that make? I'm driving, He's helping me out. Oh no, I don't want to be in that car. Let's get in the car that says God is the pilot. And we're just along for the ride. Friend, when God is at the center of your life, the circumference of your life will take care of itself. You'll never know what it means to worship the Lord if you don't know the Lord personally as your Savior. That's a fact. What you do about Jesus Christ, when you understand that you're sinful and your sin deserves and demands a payment, that payment, from a human standpoint, is hell. The Bible says, it's appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. The Bible says that Jesus Christ, understanding the heavy consequence on sin, offered Himself as a sacrifice for your sins and mine. Jesus died about 2,000 years ago, history tells us. He didn't die for His own wrongdoings because He had none. He died for our wrongdoings. But just the fact that Jesus died for sins does not mean that you personally have accepted what He did for you. And so Jesus Christ offers Himself to you as a substitute. He says, if you'll look to Me and only Me for salvation, you can be saved. Friend, people get funny about worship, and people worship a lot of things. And people talk about different kind of denominations and different things. My grandfather, who was
Roman Catholic for many years before he trusted Jesus Christ as his Savior. When we bowed our head at the dinner table to pray, he asked this question. He's being serious. He said, are we praying to your God or are we praying to my God? My dad wisely said this. He said, Bill, there's only one true God. That's who we're praying to. Friend, the Lord is your God, whether you acknowledge him or not. But he not only wants to be your God, he wants to be your Savior. How's your worship?